This past season, WTTW once more offered viewers nationwide an opportunity to meet America's best-selling authors. Channel 11 favorite Bob Cromie engages his guests in lively conversation on the Peabody Award-winning program, Book Beat.
Tell me, how long did you work with Ed?
Well, he hired me in 1948 in Europe, and I worked with him until he died. Well, not quite that, because he left CBS and gone to work for the government in 1961, but 13 years, I suppose, 48 to 61.
Well, he comes over as a lovely man, and I had always admired him, although we'd been in the same places, for London, for example, at times. I don't believe I ever met him, but he must have been a marvelous man to work with.
He was a great colleague.
With great integrity.
That was, I think, his basic characteristic, you know. It sort of stood out in everything he did, not only in matters of journalistic import, but also in his personal relations. And the most casual relations with people were really sort of marked by this appreciation of the dignity of other people.
When you say, and I'm sure it was true, that he was probably television's best-known figure.
I don't think there's any question of it. Perhaps it was by default. There was no one else really to compete with him. But also, I think it was because he sort of grew up with the medium. Television itself didn't become viable until the coax.
In addition to his weekly appearance nationally, this year Bob Cromie had an opportunity to introduce local viewers to a wide variety of people and places in our town when Chicago Is premiered last fall.
Maybe we should look and see how Hull House is now.
Fine.
This is the neighborhood approaching Hull House as it is now.
Yes, there is Hull House as it is now, as viewed from Halsted Street. You're directly across the street from the main house. And here we are going in the front door. See Mrs. Kennedy sitting at her desk. Yes. And this is the reception area, our exhibit area now, where we try to tell the story of Hull House. This is one of the original looms that was in the Labor Museum in Hull House that people worked on. There is the melodeon that Jane Addams learned to play on as a child in the Cedarville house where she grew up. The Nobel Peace Prize that she won in 1931 for her efforts on behalf of world peace.
She won a great many honors, didn't she?
A great many honors. There's the Nobel citation. There are some of the honors that she won there. There were 14 honors.
The single person who adopts a child is a new and growing phenomenon in this city. To acquaint the public with the process and rewards of this special kind of parenthood, Channel 11 presented in January, And Baby Makes Two.
Eventually, when she gets old enough, I want her to know that she's adopted and why I adopted her. And if she becomes interested in her parents and where she came from and what have you, I would refer her and give her whatever assistance I could. I would refer her to the agency. In fact, I'd bring her to the agency and get whatever information they wanted to give her or to the court or whatever was available for her, because I'd rather do that than have her coming up frustrated, wondering about her background or her heritage, rather than not telling her at all.
Conservative Viewpoint is a unique television forum for distinguished conservative scholars and spokesmen covering a broad spectrum of issues. Conservative Viewpoint was produced by WTTW for distribution on the National Educational Network.
Is there a conservative position on issues like housing, crime control, and unemployment or employment? Do you have a view on that, Mr. Kirk?
There certainly is, sir, a conservative view of our urban difficulties. I suppose the general conservative principle applies here is the conservatives' understanding of the need for roots. That we live only because we have roots in society, and that the rootless, in the phrase of Dr. Hannah Arendt, are always violent. It is, in general, lack of roots among urban people that causes the violence and indeed the poverty of the modern city. In that respect, Mr. George Romney, in his last public address as governor of Michigan before he went to Washington, uttered certain words of wisdom. He was speaking of the great riots in Detroit, and he said that the causes of these riots are now clear, and they were caused by urban renewal and by federal highway building, by bad public policy, in short, that tore people up from their roots.
Channel 11's Emmy Award-winning Bird of the Iron Feather was television's first continuing series of black drama. The story of the daily struggle to survive in Chicago's black ghetto provided absorbing drama and sharp social commentary.
It's clean. Come on, Thomas, let's go back to the car.
Now, wait a minute. Hold it. Aren't you taking this brotherhood crap a little too far? Put the cuffs on the punk.
Look, I told you he was clean. No weapon. No stolen goods. Just a scared kid.
You're gonna give him a little special treatment, huh, Rhodes? Now look, I go by the book. This kid was caught in the act of burglarizing a warehouse, and we're taking... Hey, hold it, kid! Hey, hold it now! Hold it right there! Stop! Stop or I'll shoot! Sorry, Rhodes, he's coming that way. I'll stay here and head him off. Okay, kid, just hold it right there! Okay, Rhodes, he's coming now. Hold it right there. I'm telling you for the last time, kid. Now hold it.
Don't shoot. Okay, kid. Son of a bitch.
This is the last warehouse you're gonna...
Video Nursing continues to employ the production staff and facilities of WTTW for its series of videotaped classes for use in nursing education programs nationwide. Maternity, pediatric, and psychiatric nursing are among the most recently completed series.
Now, to support the fact that depression is well known to every man, one needs only look at the lyrics of innumerable popular songs, which tell of crying the blues or of having a broken heart and the like. Also, advertising campaigns of all types. These play upon the universality of depression through their promises to pick up your spirits or put more light in your life or get you out of the dumps in some way or other. Our concern today is with the clinical problem of depression. We are focusing then today on the patient who displays a more or less stabilized, enduring affect of undue sadness, dejection, or melancholy. The patient's lowered spirits always appear.
What happens when artists from around the world phone in creative ideas to be produced for a special Chicago exhibit? Channel 11 covered these novel artworks and student reactions to them on Art by Telephone.
It's just a translation of himself, first of all, his own personal body weight, into a volume. Each pile weighs the same amount as the artist, 154 pounds. But it's also the museum building itself. This is what you build a building out of, insulation, wood, cement, plaster, and iron.
What happened to the bricks, wood, and the rest of the stuff?
There are no bricks in our building.
No bricks?
If we had bricks, there'd be bricks.
Okay. Was there any reason why you put it in this order?
It's descending order.
Go ahead.
Let me say something in general about this type of art, in that this, I would imagine, is an art whereas any normal person who finds beauty in any particular way can create, rather than, let's say, for example, Rembrandt, who had his own style of painting, right, which hardly anyone in the world could copy it or master his technique. In other words, that was him. No one else can do his thing. But now, these days, everyone has their own capabilities when it comes to art. Like, for example, throwing junk down on the floor and saying, well, that's my thing, I love it. You know, I like the way it's shaped.
The first of three Channel 11 programs dealing with the crises of hunger among us was December's widely acclaimed experimental community television format, Town Meeting, Who's Hungry in Chicago?
Proposed a bill which the president again presented to this conference this week, and this bill does nothing for Illinois. It does something for Missouri or Mississippi and Alabama and Louisiana, and we are certainly concerned about the persons in other parts of this nation. But in Illinois, we must have a more aggressive or a more progressive or more liberally administrated food stamp program if we are going to reach the people in this state.
Sir, may I say this?
Sure.
Two things I'd like to say, then I'll be through. Food stamps, I'm not too concerned about food stamps, because we're trying to pull the black poor and the white poor up. We're not trying to pull people down. These food stamps programs give a person a certain amount of inferiority. You go in a store and you're ashamed to produce these food stamps. So if the government can't elevate people, we've got enough people already feel that they're down and out, and that nobody really cares. In other words, we've got enough people on the spot. My question.
In January, our probing film documentary, To Feed the Hungry, was considered so vital to public awareness of this issue that it was broadcast 5 consecutive nights. In May, To Feed the Hungry was honored by an Emmy Award.
But if I have to take that $100 you give me for food, and I have to take $50 out of it a month to make up my rent, $30 to buy all the kids a cheap pair of gym shoes, maybe $15 of that and run back and forth to the doctor with in that month, and all the other things that are involved, then I'm starving still because I really don't have any food.
Okay. We do not have the dramatic kind of hunger that you find in Biafra. We have a hidden kind here, the kind that you find only after you talk with a person or after a good deal of observation. If you ask a person how often they think about food, you will find that they think about food 90 and 95% of the time. The mothers are beside themselves how to prepare food, how to make it stretch.
Further extending Channel 11's commitment to helping Chicagoans deal with the problem of hunger, our weekly program for the black community, Our People, invited the Reverend Jesse Jackson to deliver his Hunger Manifesto on television.
At the conclusion of Reverend Jackson's speech, you're invited to call in your questions concerning how you can get involved in this kind of fight to make certain that hunger becomes illegal. Call our action line, and our number is 588-1186. We're privileged to have in our community young, dynamic, dedicated leadership. One such person is Reverend Calvin Morris, Associate Director of SCLC's Operation Breadbasket and Director of the Anti-Hunger Campaign. Reverend Morris.
Thank you, Jim. In our nation today, there are some people who talk a great deal about the silent majority. Tonight, we need to talk just a little bit about the forgotten minority.
An original jazz ballet dramatizing a political demagogue's rise to power, performed by the Gus Giordano Dancers, was Ritual D, one of this year's highlights on Chicago Festival. To Save Tomorrow is an award-winning series which traced new frontiers in mental health therapy and showed the public that patients once thought incurable can often be returned to normal life by the use of creative new techniques.
It's a very hard thing to pinpoint, but there's a real family feeling, but it's not a family like, you know, what you grew up in. It's a nicer thing. I mean, on the basis it doesn't pin you down as much. It leaves you more leeway of really being a family. You know, you can sort of come and go and come back to it.
It was sort of a house where you make up your own mind and not have your mind made up for you. That's when I think I began to understand Walnut and to live with Walnut.
I don't have to pretend anything. That I can just be myself, whoever that is. Actually, I don't really know yet. And, you know, like feeling low and not trying to cover it up all the time like I was trying to do. As a matter of fact, I did that in the hospital, I guess, because I didn't want them to keep me there any longer than necessary, you know, than I felt was necessary, because actually the hospital wasn't here.
Channel 11 continues to offer viewers in the Chicago area the unusual opportunity of earning college credits in a wide variety of subjects and working toward a degree via television.
It seems obvious, but yet it's not. What do we mean by community colleges? As far as the community colleges, community services, is that what I said?
Yes. Well, in a way, the book is really a definition of community services. But in the book, I define the community services program, or community services, as those educational, social, cultural, and recreational activities that a community college or an institution of higher education offers above and beyond the regularly scheduled day and evening courses.
Yes, well, perhaps we might stop right here, Irv, before, or rather than list kinds of community services, at this time at least, perhaps now.
The delicate growth of a friendship between a white and a black boy, both new residents of a middle-class neighborhood, provides the context for a dramatic examination of the race issue in Stand Up for Counting, produced by WTTW for NET's What's New series.
We were right, fellas. It's a whole family of niggers.
Don't worry about them, son. They always be around someplace.
James, will you please stay?
James, are you making that noise with the ball?
Yes.
Oh. Remember those kids we saw playing ball on the way over? Why don't you go throw it around with them, okay?
I don't want to go over there. I want to stay here.
Confrontation 13th District offered a unique television platform for discussion of major issues between Philip Crane and Edward Warman, the Republican and Democratic candidates, in one of the most hotly contested elections last November. Tonight, WTTW presents Confrontation, 13th District, Crane versus Warman. This is another in a continuing series of special public affairs programs serving the Chicago area. Tonight's guests are both seeking election to Congress on November 25th from the 13th District north of Chicago. They are Philip M. Crane, the Republican candidate, and Edward A. Warman, the Democratic candidate. Serving as moderator is John Dreisky, political editor and columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times.
Gentlemen, we're on the air, and good evening. My particular objective here as the moderator is not to make peace, but instead to make war, and the flow of blood won't bother me a bit, either one of you. Now, before we went on the air, we flipped a coin. And because of the coin flip, Mr. Crane won the privilege of leading off on his two-minute short summary talk to open this program, and then Mr. Warman will follow with 2 minutes at the end of each two-minute period, gentlemen.
Just Jazz, Coleman Hawkins, a program recorded at WTTW shortly before the death of the great tenor saxophonist, was later broadcast nationwide by NET as a memorial to him.
And now we'd like to feature one of the greatest tenor saxophone players. In fact, they invented the tenor saxophone for Mr. Coleman Hawkins, and he's going to play Yesterday. How about a nice round of applause for Mr. Coleman Hawkins? Thank you.
University of Chicago Roundtable continues to feature leading scholars and public figures in open discussion of major issues and events and their impact on the American scene.
Are we just in now in one of those cyclic things where people are getting interested in what happened 100 years ago, or are there other reasons?
No, I think that we have come back to a kind of Victorianism, or at least an interest in Victorian. One of my students in a course in Victorian literature said to me yesterday, well, In Memoriam is a gut poem.
Is that a word of praise?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it's a marvelous praise. Yes.
I think what he really meant was that it didn't appeal to your mind, but to your intestines, and
that's
that
it.
Was marvelous. Mm-hmm.
Yes, how nice, yes.
What do you think about this?
I'm very pleased. Is it absolutely obvious that there would be an interest in Victorian mm-hmm. stuff, because the older, the further you are.
Channel 11 turned its eye toward the air pollution problem in Chicago and got some smoke in it. The special film documentary, Up in Smoke, investigated and reported on local pollution control and outlined what the viewer can do to join the fight for cleaner air.
In this report, we will concentrate on air pollution. The job of investigating water pollution is too dangerous. We would have to send an investigator down the Chicago River in a canoe. If he fell in, he wouldn't drown, he would dissolve. Chicago is the second most polluted city in the nation. New York is the only other American city with worse pollution.
News analysis today is a complex and difficult job. Channel 11's Fact of the Matter host, Harry Homewood, deciphers the important news each week for viewers throughout the Midwest via the Central Educational Network.
In closing, there is an air raid shelter in Albany, New York, that should be of some interest to all of us, since half of the $3.5 million it cost to build the shelter came from federal tax funds. The shelter is 100 feet deep, and it contains living quarters for 700 persons, plus quarters for housekeeping staff and policemen. There are all the comforts of home, a hospital, and food for 2 weeks. What is really interesting is the list of persons who will be allowed to use the shelter in case a nuclear attack comes. Only politicians in New York State government. There is no room for families or for children. This is perhaps just and right. If the politicians let things get to the point where the world is incinerated, it is only right that the politicians safe in the shelter should inherit what is left. Good night.
Kukla, Fran, and Ollie made a triumphant return to national television through a special series of programs produced by WTTW for NET. The Kuklapolitans and Burr Tilstrom are preparing to tape a 13-week series at Channel 11 in July.
My love loves me. Oh, look what wonders I see. A rainbow smiles in my window. My love loves me. Your eyes kissed mine. I saw your love in their shine. You showed me heaven right then when your eyes. Such beauty.
sweet time.